to see Paul Rumpa-Pum Pum. Our finest gifts we bring Paul Rumpa-Pum Pum. To lay before the king Paul Rumpa-Pum Pum. Rumpa-Pum Pum. Rumpa-Pum Pum. So to honor him Paul Rumpa-Pum Pum.
That was great. Now for me to dance. You ready? No? Stop? Is that what you said? Please. Oh, you gave me a thumbs up? You're a very kind man. You're a genius. I almost said Happy Easter. Merry Christmas. You guys excited? Yeah? Woo! Yeah. Listen, we had a great service at 2 o'clock, and I know this is going to be a great time, too. You're going to be blessed. We're going to continue on. My goal is to have us all out of here within an hour. So I'm going to pray. Well, actually, I have other goals, too, that we'd all draw closer to Jesus and see if the Lord has for us. But with that, I'm going to pray, and we'll get going. And I want to thank those kids, man. They were fabulous. And just want to praise. That was great. And let's see what the Lord wants to do with the rest of our time. Lord, we thank you for today, this day, as we recognize Christmas Eve. As we look forward to Christmas, we remember the birth of our Savior. We ask that you do great and mighty things right now with the rest of our time here. For everybody that is in this place, I give them to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation."
May it be done to me according to your word, your will. Though I can not comprehend everything that's in your plan, I believe you are at work in me. This miracle, you are alive in me. Though I'm weak, you've looked on me, such favor you to bring from heaven's throne of majesty. Now you're here to set me free. My Lord, my God, you are holy, holy. My Lord, my King, you are worthy.
Yeah.
Thank you. That was great. Thank you, Michaela. Thank you, everybody. You know what? Michaela and I talked about this a little bit ago. Just so you know, she sang the solo. I won't have you talk, but she sounds like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. She has a really bad cold, and she sang like that. And I think, what a praise report. I mean, you know Rudolph, you know,
from the cartoon, you know, Rudolph?
I mean, but she said I could say that. Is that okay with you? You look so upset with me for saying that. I'm sorry. She said I could. Man, but that was great. What a real blessing. And you know, just, you know, I'm sitting there just thinking, this is so cool and so engaging to have the whole band and then the choir and all the different singers. And I'm thinking, you know, if you're here and you have a real gift, even young dancers, I'm looking at everything going, not me. But if you have a real gift in music, you can use it here and just, you know, in choir, send in your name. But you really have to have a gift. I mean, you can't be like me and just think you can sing. And all right? But if you do, man, what a blessing. That truly was a blessing. So let's get on with this, because you all probably want to go home and do whatever you're going to do. So I think, okay, we live here in the Hemet San Jacinto Valley. Some of you might be visiting friends or family right now. So I'll introduce you to something that we have here. One thing we have is that every Christmas we have this informal Jeep light parade. It is really cool. How many of you have ever seen the Jeep light parade at Christmas time going around the valley? It is so awesome. Every year I just happen to catch it, and man, these things are lit up. It is totally off the charts. But one other thing that's really unique to Hemet in San Jacinto Valley is the annual Christmas parade down Florida Avenue. Is it not? Well, let's just take a little journey through it. So here it is. This picture was from a year or two ago from the City of Hemet annual Christmas parade. And so we have our own version of how to do them. We have marching bands. We have all kinds of things in our Hemet parade. We get the finest of police cars out there. And that's actually a cool car. I would like to have that. That is a cool car. And but, you know, we're not the Rose Parade, but we do a pretty good job with our floats, as you can see by this one. And again, we are, you know, this is our valley. And, you know, this is what we do here, right? And in the Hemet Parade this year, we had Cousin Eddie from Christmas Vacation. So some of you know Cousin Eddie, right? And some of you don't. So I'll just Cousin Eddie was in Christmas Vacation with Chevy Chase and so forth. And this isn't the real Cousin Eddie. So this person, I saw this on Facebook. He happens to be my neighbor that lives across the street. I took a snapshot of it. I sent it to him. I said, that's you, isn't it? So his name is Jason. And you don't have to worry about this particular Cousin Eddie showing up here, because he's a Baptist. So he's not going to be here, so we're going to be okay. Maybe you have a Cousin Eddie in your family. I don't know. Maybe you're Cousin Eddie. I don't know. But anyways, we have a lot of fun here in this valley. And I look at things, and God is good. But I think of Christmas time. And indeed, when it comes to Christmas, there's a lot of different thoughts that come to mind. Just the other night, Saturday evening, we went to my folks' house. My dad had celebrated his, I think, 88th birthday a couple weeks ago. So we went over with them. It was myself and Jackie and our kids. And both my mom and dad are in their upper 80s. And, you know, as they've gotten older, your body doesn't work the same way it used to. From complications with sight to all the other problems that you start to have. And there's a lot of them as you get older. I remember when my grandmother, my mom's mom, when she got Alzheimer's, and you know, you see those things. So my mom and dad don't get around quite like they used to. Driving is a different experience than it used to be, and all that. And we're going through their home in Murrieta and just looking at pictures from when our kids were super little. They're still pretty young, but when our son was born, to pictures when there's no kids, pictures when I wasn't even married and my hair was down to here. It really was. I had some seriously long hair, but that was back when I used to listen to Led Zeppelin, too, and all that other stuff. And But it was kind of a trip down nostalgia lane, and then pictures that are updated, and just looking at them and realizing how life just changes. And then being in ministry for decades now, plural, you see babies born into families, and you see families lose somebody. They've gone on to heaven. Their time on earth is done. You're around long enough, you see babies grow up and go through the different stages. You see kindergartners. You start to realize any family goes through this. Your kindergartners end up in elementary school, then on to junior high. Then they grow up into high school, and you're watching your kids grow. And then they're gone from high school. They move out, get married. Next thing you know, you have grandkids, and you watch this progression. And you realize, man, time flies, doesn't it? That's one of the things that I've really recognized now that I'm a little bit older. I'm not really old, and I'm not really young. To some people who are really young, I'm really old. I'm probably really old to some of you there. But to old people, I'm kind of young. What did I say yesterday? I think I gave you my age yesterday if you were here at service. I'm 41 now. And being 41 is really a remarkable thing to... You know, some people believed that when I told them yesterday. There's a fool born every minute. I think P.T. Barnum said that. But in all seriousness, as I have gotten older, and look at things, my mom and dad, look at kids, you see there's a cycle. A giant wheel seems to keep turning. And Solomon wrote about that in the book of Ecclesiastes. He said, to everything there is a season, a time to be born, a time to die. And they just went on, a time of war, a time of peace. The Birds, if you were around in the 60s, you might remember that song, to everything, turn, turn, turn. Remember that song? There's a season, turn, and life is like that. And it's just this never-ending thing, this progression, and you watch. And as I have gotten older, in all seriousness, I think I've gotten a lot more focused on particular things, a lot more introspective on myself. And I've also realized that things to me as a pastor that really used to matter really don't matter anymore. Things to me that didn't matter before matter a lot more now. I care a lot more now about how people feel than I used to care about how people feel. I can tell God is continuing to change me. And there's a different focus. And you start to realize what matters in life and what doesn't. Here's what matters. According to the Bible, other people matter. Loving God matters. And the Christmas story, the true Christmas story, is that this is what matters most, is that God loves us. So much so that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. And God did not send his son. Jesus himself said this. God did not send his son into this world to condemn us, but that through him we would be saved. The fact that he says we would be saved implies that we need to be saved from something. So Jesus was saying, God did not send me into this world as a babe in a manger, only to grow old and die on a cross to condemn you. That's not why I came. I came that you might know hope, that you might know peace, that you might know forgiveness, that you might know heaven, that you might have genuine peace, that you might have real joy. Hence, in the Gospel of Matthew, the Bible says of the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, says, and she, that would be the young woman named Mary, will bring forth a son, and his name shall be called Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. God loves you. Jesus didn't come to condemn, he came to forgive. And for anyone that trusts him, your eternal home is in the place the Bible describes as heaven. But a little bit more perspective on heaven and eternity and why Jesus came. Let me illustrate this for you. Back in October of this year, just a couple of months ago, the Mega Millions lottery jackpot on October 18th, I don't know what happened on October 19th, but on October 18th, the Mega Millions jackpot hit $1.6 billion. That's a lot of money. That's a whole lot of money. So a question was asked regarding the lottery. In fact, this question appears in different ways with pretty much every lottery, and it's this, and people go online, they do the polls. Would winning the lottery bring you happiness? Results? 37% say yes, it would solve most, if not all, of my problems. Good luck with that one, right? 23% said no, there is more to life than what money can buy. 40% said, not sure, but it would be nice to find out. I'm going to confess, I fall in the 40% range. I should be in the 23%. I'm a pastor. Okay, I can say I know there's more to life than what money can buy. I know that. But I wouldn't mind if God tested me with the other option, just, you know, that it would be. We live in a world where people are looking for their problems to be solved. They've lost hope. Money can't save their problems. Government will not solve your problems. I don't know if you've been paying attention, but if you have, our government shut down. You know that? Listen, government is definitely not going to solve your problems. I believe Ronald Reagan is right. Government's going to cause you more problems. The bigger the government, more problems you're going to have. What we need is a Savior. His doors never closed. He never shuts down anyone that will turn to him. So another perspective. So the lottery, Mega Millions in October, $1.6 billion U.S. dollars. That's a lot. Also in October, 2 months ago, Paul Allen, the co-founder of Microsoft, died. He had a lot more money than the Mega Millions winner. His net worth, I don't know what his gross worth was, but his net worth was over $20 billion. That is an outrageous amount of money. I'll give you a perspective. That is way more money than Donald Trump has. $20 billion is a lot of money. But the lottery can't save a person's soul. And no matter how many billions a person has, they cannot buy their way into heaven. We need a Savior. Everybody, from the poorest person alive to the richest person alive, we all will experience something in common. We will all die. The statistics have never changed. One out of one person dies. It ain't going to change. From the poorest person to the richest person, and we're all going to die the same way. Our money ain't going with us. Our stuff ain't going with us into heaven. None of that. The only thing we have on that day is what we had with the Lord. And the Lord loves us. The Lord himself said, I did not come to condemn you. I came with the purpose of saving you. So the Bible tells us the Christmas story, born to you this day is a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Luke tells us a little bit more detail about the Christmas story. There's a man named Joseph who was married to Mary. They made their journey from Nazareth on down to Bethlehem because there was a census. And when they arrived at Bethlehem, Mary was pregnant, and it was time for her to give birth. So when they arrived at Bethlehem, they went to the inn, and the innkeeper said, there's no rooms available here. It ain't going to work. So they went out to a stable where all the animals were, and there Mary gave birth to her son and laid him in a manger, her son named Jesus. And Luke writes, for there's born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. So again, we have the term Savior. So Savior implies that you must be saved from something. The Bible tells us that he is the Savior of the world for anybody who would come to him for their sins. So a savior implies you need to be saved from something. If you are in severe debt and you're about ready to file bankruptcy, maybe your rich dad comes along and he writes you a check and he pays off all your debt and he saves you from bankruptcy. He's a savior. The lifeguard at the beach is the savior of the one who was in the ocean drowning, saying, "Help me, help me." The lifeguard of eternal life is Jesus, and he saves us from drowning in sin and judgment, and he even saves us, or mostly, I guess you could say, he saves us from ourselves. My biggest problem is me. It's not you. It's not my family. It's not church. It's not my bank account. My biggest problem is me. Charles Spurgeon said, "Beware of no man more than of yourself. We carry our worst enemies within us." So born to you this day is, in the city of David, is the Savior who is Christ the Lord, and he loves you. Just two things I want to give you before you go out and celebrate whatever you're going to do for the rest of Christmas, because this is an exciting time. Christmas means. Number one is this. God sent his son to save us because we need saving. So let me explain it a little bit. Jesus is born and laid in a manger. He grows up to be a man. When he's in his young 30s, he's nailed to a cross, and he's judged for the sins of anyone who would believe in him. He's laid in a tomb for 3 days. He's dead. He rises after the third day, and he ascends into heaven. Here's what happened on the cross. Where the Bible teaches that Jesus is Savior and he's judged for our sins, it means this. If you say yes to Jesus, if you come to him for the forgiveness of your sins, and you happen to be a liar, it means that Jesus was judged as if he told your lies. He was judged in your place so you won't be judged for the lies you've told or the other things that you have done, whatever those other things may have been. And you want to know something? Here's the beauty of it. It covers every single sin that a person could ever commit, even the worst of sins. The worst sinner could never sin worse than Jesus can forgive. Jesus can forgive murders, and he's done it. Jesus forgives liars. Jesus forgives thieves. Jesus forgives gossipers. Did you know gossip is a sin? It is. All the person has to do is just say yes to Jesus. That's remarkable. And on the cross, your sin, the Father looks at the Son as if he committed your sins, and he didn't commit any sins. So he was judged for your sins. So when you die, you won't be judged for your sins, and you will rise to eternal life. That's a pretty good deal. But think through this with me for just a second. The true story of Christmas is that Jesus came. If he didn't come, the story of Christmas, as Tim Keller said, is one moral paradigm to crush you. Keller went on to say, if Jesus didn't come, I wouldn't want to be anywhere around these Christmas stories that say we need to be sacrificing. I wouldn't want to be anywhere around these Christmas stories that say we need to be humble. I wouldn't want to be anywhere around these Christmas stories that say we need to be loving. All that will do is crush you into the ground, because if it isn't true, then truly Christmas is depressing. Every year, I see stories saying Christmas is the time of year for depression. But it is not if you believe in Jesus. It is not if you say yes to Jesus. Because Jesus forgives us. He's the one who saves. He's judged for our sins, so we won't be judged for our sins. Born to you this day in the city of David is the Savior. Last thing I want to leave you with is this thought. God promises genuine peace to anyone who would come to him. I will tell you where genuine peace was not. Around 11 o'clock this morning, it was not at Stater Brothers. I was there, the Stater Brothers out in Val Vista, with my shopping cart and 73,000 other folks, and I'm going through there, and here's what I was doing. I had a list. I wanted to bless my wife because we have a really big Christmas dinner or lunch or something like that tomorrow we're going to in San Diego down at my brother's house. And I have a very large family, 7 brothers and sisters. And then there's cousins, there's nieces, there's nephews. There's like 8 million people there. So we'll be down there. Almost all of them live down in the San Diego area. So all I have to do is buy salad ingredients. So I've got the basket. I have this list. I got every single ingredient on the salad list. The cost? $91.87 for salad. I don't eat salad. I don't like salad. I don't care how you dress it up. I told someone earlier, the only way, this is how I like salad. I like it with bacon, not bacon bits, bacon, maybe some carnitas inside, wrapped up inside of a tortilla with some hot sauce. That's how I'm going to eat salad. Maybe some refried beans in there. That's a salad to me. I'm not going to eat a salad in a bowl or a plate. It's rabbit food. I can't do that. So some of you may be thinking, well, that pastor's really mean. No, listen, $91 can buy a lot of really good prime steak. You know what I mean? Oh, yeah. Now, to me, that makes sense. Let's do a barbecue for Christmas. A salad? $91. And how many people, this is my family, I know my family. How many of them are going to eat vegetables? There's no happiness to my bank account over that $91 that took off for the salad. There is no peace in my heart for buying and those poor people at Stater Brothers that got to work these hours right now. Yikes, pray for them. In all seriousness, when the promise of the Savior was given to Mary, the Bible says that the angel proclaimed that in him would be genuine, and we just sang this, the choir did a few minutes ago, peace and goodwill toward men. Genuine peace. Real peace. Why? Because you've met him. You've said yes to him. And you go, wow, I'm relieved of all this guilt. I'm relieved of all this stuff. There's a joy I can't explain. I read years ago, and it's so true for anybody who's asked Christ to forgive them, and what you experience immediately, it's like trying to describe the sounds of Beethoven to a person who's never heard music, or to a person who's never seen, trying to describe the Grand Canyon or something like that. They have no concept of color. That's what it means to say yes to Jesus. Somebody says yes to Jesus, like, wow, I cannot believe this happened. I've shared this here at this church before, so bear with me. I'd like to close just with this thought. A couple of years ago, I was on a radio interview. It was a live radio interview. It was 5 o'clock East Coast time. The radio was being broadcast in New York City, Manhattan area. I'm here in my office, and the host is asking me all kinds of different questions. I didn't have any preset questions. They didn't email them to me, text me, or anything. It was just all off the cuff. They're going to ask me questions. And they did. And so we get through. It was an hour long. It's live. Get down to the end of the program. The host says, okay, I have a couple of minutes left. I want this. I perceive that you are a religious man. I'm thinking, gee, I wonder what kind of answers I gave him. If I perceive you're a religious man, why don't you tell the people, this question went something like this, what it is that motivates you or what it is that drives you. And I thought, wow. And I didn't have, you know, it's radio, so you got like a second to think. That's about it. And so I know it was the Lord. And I thought immediately, I've got people listening that are some of the poorest people in New York City to some of the richest hedge funders could possibly be listening to this radio program right now, wherever they are. You don't know who the Lord has listening. So I thought to myself, what's the one thing in common that every single person has that hasn't said yes to Jesus? It's a lack of genuine peace. It's a lack of genuine happiness. And so I just keyed in on that, and I said, you know what? I gave my life to the Lord before I said yes to Jesus. And I said, you know what? I tried to find my peace, my joy, my happiness in anything I could, and it didn't satisfy. There's a hole in my heart. And I knew what I was lacking. Every night I go to bed and I didn't have peace. We try to find peace in the Christmas decorations, the manger scenes, We must say yes to Jesus. Listen, Jesus came because we need a Savior. He didn't come to condemn, and he loves you. If I could get that point across more than anything else, this is what Christmas is about. He loves you. He forgives. He wants you to experience his peace. He wants you to experience his joy. He wants you to experience his happiness. He wants this to be your best Christmas ever. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to say yes to Jesus right now. Will you bow your heads with me in a word of prayer? Lord, we thank you for Christmas, Christmas time, the hope, the peace, the genuine peace, just as your word tells, peace and goodwill toward men. Lord, I lift up everybody in here to you, and especially anybody in here, those who are here, who are thinking, man, I want to say yes to Jesus. I've held back. I want to know his peace. I want to experience his joy. I want to experience heaven. I want to know his forgiveness. Or maybe you're in here and you're thinking, I've said yes before, but I wasn't serious. This time I want to be serious because this is what I want. I want to experience the best Christmas ever. I want to say yes to him. Listen, if that's you, while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, go ahead and slip up your hand wherever you are, high where I can see it. I'm going to pray for you before you leave here. God bless you. I see your hand on the left. See your hand in the back on the left. See your hand in the middle. God bless you guys. See your hand over there on the right. Middle. I see your hand. See your hand by the sound booth. God bless you guys. Amen. I see your hand way over there on the right. See your hand there on the right. See your hand there in the middle. I see your hand. God bless you. God bless you too in the middle. God bless you way over there on the left. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Father, I lift up these who raised their hands. Hands I saw, hands I didn't see, and I ask that you administer right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen real carefully. This is going to take 1 minute. And I'm going to ask that nobody moves around right now except those who are saying, I want to say yes to Jesus. This is what Jesus did. When Jesus said, follow me, he said, come, follow me. And anybody he said that to, he called them publicly and openly, come on up and follow me. And they did. That is saying yes to Jesus. And also Jesus said this, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. But if you acknowledge me, if you say yes to me before men, I will say yes before my Father in heaven. In other words, you say yes to me here, man, I'll say yes to you there. As you stand before the pearly gates, I'll say yes. Listen, if that's you, you raised your hand. If I saw it, I saw a lot of hands. Or even if I didn't see your hand, listen, right now I'm going to give that opportunity to say yes to Jesus, just as he did, just as he says, come follow me. So if you stand up wherever you are, come on down here and face me. I'm going to pray for you right now. It's going to be the best Christmas you ever had. Come on down. Amen.
We know.
Amen. This is awesome. God loves you. I said yes to Jesus many years ago, and God took the biggest loser I've ever met, which was me, and now he has me out here. This is unbelievable. This is just fantastic. This will be the best Christmas ever, really. And next year you can be in the Hemet Christmas Parade as a believer. Lucky you. No. Listen, I'm going to pray with you, and the prayer is commonly called the sinner's prayer. It's a prayer of asking Christ to forgive you. It's a prayer of repentance. To repent means to make a decision to turn from your sin and turn to Christ, which is saying yes to Jesus. And it's a prayer of just acknowledging you're a sinner too. And if you pray this and you mean it, you can know that you are forgiven, and not only that, you are forgiven right now. That's really good, isn't it? That is great. So with that, I'm going to lead you in prayer. While all of you are sitting down, let's stand up and encourage these folks who are down here. Ready? Go ahead and pray this after me. This is great. This really is. Go ahead and pray after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I recognize I'm a sinner, and I ask that you will forgive me of my sin. I repent of my sin, and I surrender to you as Lord. I thank you for forgiving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. That's awesome. This is fantastic. It really is. I'm going to pray one more prayer, all right? Lord, I pray for every person that came forward that they would experience a double portion of your peace and your joy this Christmas season. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. A double portion. Amen. With that, if you could turn to my left, we want to give you a Bible before you leave, and before we don't want to just kick you out with nothing. So we want to give you a Bible before you leave. Turn my left and your right. And with that, listen, we have one closing song. This isn't the exit song. Just saying, all right? This is the song where we say we want to praise the Lord together before we exit, okay? So you ready? Sam, take it away. Where are you?
Joyful and triumphant, O come, ye, O come.
Christmas to you all.